the on-demand learning section of our website. All the attendees' phones are on listen-only mode by default, but we'd like you to stay engaged by using the question discussion pod for comments and questions. We have a question and answer session at the end of the webinar, so if you have any questions, we encourage all of you to enter them in the questions pod as soon as they come to your mind at any time. The questions will be read out loud one at a time by the moderator, and our presenters will each answer each question. So that is all I have, and with that, I'll hand it over to our moderator, Paul Jodoin, to start us off.
Thank you, Zach, and once again, thank you for the Center of Excellence support on this. Zach, I'm not seeing the presentation screen. I don't know if that's just me or. But with that, well, I'll proceed anyways. So there we go. I feel a lot better. Oh, I want to see myself. But anyways, thank you everyone for joining us. I know these are challenging times for everyone. While we're, at least Jim and I and most of us are trying to proceed as business as usual, it's not really business as usual, is it? So, but I think with our discipline, we're going to still need to do what we need to get done for the motorists of this country and the responders and everything else we do. It might even be more critical now than ever. So we're going to continue as normal, and from our homes in large part. But we have our hearts and souls with those on the roadway. One of our presenters today could not make it. We had a fire captain from Houston lined up because of that very nice presentation. But he is deployed to deal with the COVID-19 issue. So certainly we'll probably be seeing more and more about on that. So with that, I will just give you a heads up and hand over to my partner in crime here, Jim Austrich. I just wanted to give a quick advertisement to, I'm involved with crowdsourcing for operations effort. It's an everyday counts effort for you, those that don't know what everyday counts is. For those of you that don't, I'm not going to explain that now to you, but basically we're trying to advance the use of crowdsourcing. And one of the reasons is that we got money for this project is during the TIM Data Initiative, EDC4, we started to hear about people doing all these cool things with crowdsourcing, in particular Waze data. So we put in for a project. We got it. I'm co-chair or deputy lead, I would call it more, with a colleague, James Collier, at the Office of Operations. But one of the webinars that we're conducting, again, in cooperation with the Center of Excellence, is the use of crowdsourcing for managing and helping with the back of the queue, which we know is near and dear to our hearts when we're trying to improve on responder and motorist safety. So wanted to let you know about that webinar that's coming up, and these are the speakers. They're all highly talented and highly sophisticated practitioners. Ed Cox is one of the leading data people in the country when it comes to anything data, crowdsourcing and operations and anything. He's does a lot of cool things with mostly INRIX data. And Brian Purvis, along with one of our speakers today, is an old friend who's been a TIM practitioner and a very smart guy for a long, long time. So these are basically TIM experts, and Lee Hahn actually works with the Texas Department of Transportation. Tennessee Department of Transportation does a lot of work with them with the TIM program. So it's a lot of TIM stuff even though it's a crowdsourcing for operations. So if you can join us on April 8th, 1:30 to 3, and as all Center of Excellence website webinars, it will be recorded. So if you can't make it, look for it. And then I just wanted to give Zach, my slide isn't moving. Zach, are you there?
Oh. Yeah, I'm here. I'm also trying to move it forward, and it doesn't seem to be progressing.
It's not moving
itself as well. No.
Okay. Not moving for you either? Okay.
No,
no problem.
Unfortunately.
I was just going to advertise our next upcoming webinar. I actually have the speakers all set for the next Talking Tim at the end of April. Remember, all the webinars are on the fourth Wednesday of the month, except for maybe the holidays or something like that. You'll be notified. We have some pretty cool speakers for that all lined up, which I forget right this second, but we'll see if we can get you that information before we call it a day. So with that, I'll stop talking and pass it over to my colleague, Mr. James Austrich, who will give you an update on the National Responder Training. So, Mr. Austrich. Jim, are you on mute? Oh, Jim? Uh-oh. Okay.
All right, I'm going to try to see if Jim, I see him on here. Let me just see if I can combine him and make sure he can speak to us. Hold on one second. Sorry.
Okay, microphone on now. Can you hear me?
Yep. All right, we can hear you.
Yep. Wow. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Zach. And I started to say to echo Paul, thank you, everyone. It's nice to see the number that we have here thus far, 83. Attending today's webinar, and as Paul said, challenging time that we're in for sure, but as you hear said, have heard said, this too shall pass, and we'll come back stronger than ever. As the National TIM Training report loads up here, hopefully in a second, I just wanted to the first slide covers the current state since January of the struck by line of duty deaths, those related directly to traffic incident management operations, incidents along our nation's roadways involving, our disciplines. And hate to report that the number that I have is 14 right now. Seven, you don't see the slide yet, but seven law enforcement, two fire, two fire, four towers, and one DOT worker in Arizona. As you see here, I hope everybody can see it now. The total there, this is an older slide. This isn't my updated slide. But regardless, it's two firefighters, seven law enforcement officers, four towers, and one service patrol as of today. So the one thing I want to point out that I added to this slide is, and you'll hear Paul and I talk more at the end about this, is the call to action to continue the training even through these difficult times. I've had conversations over the past couple of weeks with a number of you regarding the option that exists out there and that is really one that's exploding across all areas of education, et cetera, but certainly And I think thankfully that we have the TIM training available through the National Highway Institute and our partners over at Responder Safety Learning Network, respondersafety.com. So I posted the URLs to be able to access those two trainings free of charge. And again, as you always hear me say, Paula and I all agree it isn't the best way to receive this training, but I think all states, everyone, and agencies, public safety and otherwise, should consider this as an option through this time. I just feel strongly about this, and you know, it's free, and even though you're flying solo as a responder through this training, it's just a way of doing this while we're practicing this social distancing. The last bullet is to struck by line of duty death URL, where our friends again at respondersafety.com, Cumberland Valley Volunteer Fire Association, that gave birth to respondersafety.com, they are now our only one-stop shop, if you will, for the statistics. So I highly encourage you to visit respondersafety.com if you like. A lot of great free training there. Let me see if I can move the slide. Okay, very good. So anyway, this is the cover slide. We had not reported. This is the first report in slightly over a month, but regardless, the bottom number, you can see we're just about 30,000 shy of 500,000 responders trained nationally. And all thanks to you on this call today and many others that can't join us today for whatever the reason, but we continue this charge, whether it's secondary crashes and line of duty deaths and just in general making travel more reliable for our nation's road users. Responder safety, motor safety, you know, all the reasons why we took on this effort over eight years ago, real soon here in June, and it continues on very strong, thanks to all of you. The map here, standard map of all the train-to-trainer sessions in the country, the only official one that I have right now, that is going to come later in probably summer is in the state of Nevada, and anybody that may be interested and can, you know, has approved authority to travel may be interested in contacting Pat Gallagher and the team in Nevada to register. Granted, we don't know what the situation is going to be at that time as far as COVID-19, but I share that. Then there's also all the other, I'm sure, other state-led train-the-trainer sessions that are occurring, but that one is one that I'm aware of, wanted to share. The other, this map here is shows the number of trainers nationally. Won't get into that. The map here that you see, again, the grand total between in-person and web-based training. Web-based training is growing. I will say, I must qualify this, that because similar to even this platform here, Adobe Connect platform, whether it's Zoom, whether it's GoToMeeting, WebEx, all the different platforms that are out there for distance learning, online learning, training, they're being overwhelmed, I'm sure. And, you know, you, depending on your system, your database will dictate, your hardware will dictate how well you're able to go through whatever the training is. But I know at the National Highway Institute, there's a huge influx in demand. And when you register
if you go online to NHI to look for our course, the register, you'll see the alerts there. So moving forward here, the total trained again nationally. Shout out to, who was it? I don't know if, Katie, are you on by chance? I'm trying to think of, you had a couple states.
She would be muted anyways.
Oh, that's true, Paul. Thanks. Anyway, there's a couple more states that hit the...
Hey, Jim. I think you just added me. It's Texas and South Carolina that just exceeded 55%.
Thank you, Katie. I could not remember. Thank you.
Yep.
So related to this map that you see here, our goals map, we're giving a shout-out to those two states for the accomplishment. And all states, you know, we're pleasantly surprised that you're keeping the momentum going and for all the right reasons. With that, let me see here. This is the bar chart showing the totals. Back a minute here. Remember, for those of first-time viewers or first-time guests today, in the lower left here, you see that 1.158 million responders that we have a goal of reaching, of which now we're at 41% of that number, fast approaching 500,000. So with that, Paul, I'll turn it back over to you.
Excellent. Excellent. Thanks. Thanks, Jim. And we know that Jim and I have heard that a lot of the in-person trainer sessions, all training sessions, four-hour sessions as well, have been postponed for now. So so we understand that that's what has to happen right now. As much as we think online training is second best, it's still a good method of getting the information out there, and hopefully we'll pick this back up once this epidemic is passed. But Jim and I are trying to think of creative ways to keep things going here with the training, because we have had so much progress, and we expect to be doing more and not less moving forward. In person, not for a while it seems, but right with Jim, we're hoping to make some. Some creative thinking here to keep things going.
Yeah.
And hopefully we'll do that.
And Paul, I was remiss real quick in saying our last webinar last month, we presented on the TIM instructor-led virtual training. If you'd like to listen and see the recording on that new tool, which is basically the same web-based training at NHI, but it's a more, it's an interactive tool, if you will, and I've been talking to folks across the country that are interested in that. It hasn't officially launched, but if you want to get ready, you want to learn more about it, watch the recording that's available here at the National Operations Center of Excellence, or give Paul or myself a call. Thanks, Paul.
Yeah. Excellent. Okay, so our next two presenters, I have one relatively new friend and one very, very old friend. And Eric Hemphill is a relatively new friend. I'm missing your title, but I know he's a senior position for the Texas Toll Authority. He is, him and I serve on a pretty cool project, a TRB and CHRP project for using big data to improve traffic incident management. So we've been helping over the last few years. We'll continue to help a project to see what benefit we can come up with out of this onslaught of big data that's coming at the country. I've come to know Eric well enough to know that he is innovative in his thinking, and he has some opportunities, and one of his near and dear to his heart, as it is to everyone, every single person on this webinar, is responder safety. So I heard he was doing some cool things relative to responder safety and other related TIM activity, so I've asked Eric to present to us today. So Eric, if you don't mind, take it away.
All right, thanks, Paul. Again, my name is Eric Hemphill. I'm the Director of Traffic Incident Management for the North Texas Tollway Authority. And just really quick, I want to touch on that the North Texas Tollway Authority is a state agency in the state of Texas. We've actually been around longer than 1997, but prior to 1997, we did toll roads throughout Texas. We are now focused on the six counties around the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex by our Texas legislature back in 1997. A real quick look at where we serve. Dallas is on your right, Fort Worth is on your left as you're looking at the map. The Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex has about 6.8 million people in it, and we run roads all the way across it. To give you an idea, if you wanted to drive from the bottom left corner where our road touches 67 and go all the way up to the north, it'll be about a two-hour drive to get there from one side to the other. So, fairly large, expansive system in a very growing area. And then what we do, our primary focus, as Paul mentioned, is to keep everybody moving safely. last year, we did around 45,000 calls for service, and from start to finish, being aware of the problem to get you on your road is about 16 minutes and 19 seconds is what we're averaging right now. I do want to say that does not include crashes. With crashes, we'd be about 50,000 calls for service. But what I do say is that the 44,000 calls we've been on, I tell our team that's 44,000 crashes we've prevented, either helping somebody with a flat tire, giving them a gallon of gas, moving debris from a roadway, push, pull, drag a stalled vehicle out of the way. As everybody on the line knows, that any one of those leads to massive and severe crashes. So 44,702 times our team prevented crashes last year, and did it in a pretty quick fashion. If you think about 16 minutes and 19 seconds, that does include changing tires. So, and how we do it, we have a couple of vehicles in our fleet. Now, the one on your left is basically a one-ton service vehicle that has a push bumper and a drag bumper. We can push, pull, drag things out of the way. And when we can't, we use the one on the right. That is what we call here a safety recovery vehicle. Most people look at that and say that's a little small wrecker. We want to be clear to the public when we pull up that we are not there to tow you to your uncle's house or to the nearest body shop or anything like that. We are simply hooking you up, snatching your car out, and getting it out of the road into a parking lot where we can do the crash paperwork or even help you with the tire change there if we're in a dangerous situation and we don't want our people in a curve changing a tire. We'll snatch the vehicle, take it to a parking lot, and fix the tire there. And typically there's nobody driving over 70 miles an hour in a parking lot as they would be in that dangerous situation. So I'm going to start talking about some of the things we do, and you're going to ask, well, that doesn't look too high tech there. But it's not a high tech, but it is very important to our employee safety. As you see, three views of the cone rack that I want you to focus on. The cones are sitting on a little cone rack in the back we hooked to a trailer hitch. Although it doesn't seem like a big deal, these cone racks have allowed us to improve our employee safety by allowing them to face traffic to pull cones out to deploy. If they're stuck in the back of the truck, they have to turn their back for even a little bit to climb up in the back of the truck to get the cones out. Or if they're in the back of the truck, they stress, strain, pull to get them out a little bit. So it's not only not getting in and out of the back of the truck, we're not taking our eyes off traffic. And as we know, for every second you're traveling 100 feet, although you turn your back for a couple seconds, there's a car right up on you really quick. It also has a built-in little feature where the step helps you get into the tailgate. So if we do get into the tailgate, that's a smaller step in and out for the guys. It's been a wonder. You might also notice that the toolboxes are open on both sides of this truck. It's kind of give you an idea that we do keep two sets of tools on either side of the truck that allows our team to basically get on in and out of the toolboxes and serve the public without ever having to be on the side of traffic. So most of the group here that I've seen log on has cameras. Here's one of our typical camera arrays. These are our eyes in the sky. You'll see four fixed cameras and one pan tilt zoom. Those pan tilt zooms are typically what we use to keep an eye on their employees. We have a standard protocol that when a guy is on a call, We do keep a camera on him and keep it up on our display board in our traffic operations center. That traffic operations center also dispatches state troopers. So if we do have an issue or employee might get into a scuffle or come into a problem, we've got immediate dispatch of state troopers to their rescue. It also helps us if they start to get into a pickle and it looks worse than it is. So keeping the pantail zoomed on the employees has been one of our big pushes to help us keep them safe. Now, the four fixed cameras see the world like you see on the two pictures on the right. The top one is basically saying, hey, I'm looking for anything in this area that does not belong. And the bottom one, you can see what it does when it does find something that doesn't belong. It alerts us to a stranded vehicle. And not only does that help us go find people before they're even aware that we know they're there, it helps us with safety of our employees, because if they leave their vehicle, we have to sticker it and we'll have to tow it, which means we have to bring out a state trooper or a record driver just to move the vehicle. If we can catch them before they leave, not only does it improve their safety, it improves our safety by requiring less people to actually respond to the scene. And there they are. So I'm going to jump into a little bit of some of the equipment we use on our trucks. You might have seen it when it had the tools doors open. These are flares that will show you the way. Basically, we use LED flares in addition to cones to help traffic. We don't use the light-up flares because, as you saw, 16 minutes and 19 seconds, sometimes we're in and out before those flares would go out. And crash scenes were cleared in less than an hour is our goal. So, again, flare time is very important for us. So using the portable flare systems. Now, what's different about these that are typical flare systems we've been using is they are sequential. What you see on the left is a picture of the flare itself, a pilot light, we call it. And on the right is the carrying case. That carrying case is also the charging station, so it's easy to deploy. You can pull off those things in any order, hit the power button, drop it to the ground, and they know what order they come in, or they know what order you're taking them off at. As you turn them on, they'll be in order, and you can control all of them with just one by holding one. You don't have to touch either, and they go in a sequential order to direct traffic. And so here's a picture. I am now going to attempt a video. If I do not do this correctly, I will act it out with my hands and everybody will have to watch. So there you'll see the sequential flares in action. We did put them in this picture. We put them in the front of cones to reflect off the cones and give a little bit more. You see they're directing the way traffic goes. If that person wanted to turn them to go the other direction or actually make them continuous flash or slow burn, any other thing, he would just have to grab one, connect it, or grab one, push the button, and it would do it all. So that's a little bit about our sequential flares as I try to return back to the presentation. All right. So we go from there to basically a different kind of camera. These cameras show, as you can see, the inside, the front, back, and inside. These help us with safety because, first of all, we do a lot of transports. The camera automatically is on when we have a transport, and you can see our driver there by himself. We don't have anybody in that picture. But if there was somebody in the truck, we have a video of them and what they might be doing or what they might accuse our driver of doing. The other two pictures show the front and back. I would say that the back picture is great. Unfortunately, we do get struck. We average about one strike a month, and we total about three vehicles a year. The back camera actually does very good in helping us determine how we were positioned right prior to the crash, so we can see that everything was going well on our side, or you could see that the person just never paid attention and struck right in the back of us. The front camera keeps an eye on what's going on, helps us with claims. We, as I mentioned, 44,000 calls. Sometimes people indicate that we break their lug nuts or maybe tear up part of their car. We do keep a video recording of that call just to make sure that nothing went wrong for a little while. It does pop up and give us alerts. If somebody starts to drive over 75 miles an hour, their camera comes on. We are not first responders, so we must also follow the traffic laws as far as speed. although we are allowed to drive on the shoulders as approved by our DPS counterparts that we dispatch. So, and one thing we are working on, we are hoping to having it done by this webinar, but not quite. We will be live streaming this video right back to our traffic operations center. So as somebody's on a call and pulling up to a call, we'll be able to see what they're working on and what the situation like it looks like. For a crash, for example, if we see things that we just can't quite see from the camera in the air to get a better idea of what's going on. The next thing is getting a message to the public. So here what you see is a board. It looks slightly skewed in this picture, and it is because it actually rotates all the way around. This board, as I try one more time to share my screen and show you a little video. So as you can see in the picture, this board turns all the way around. I apologize for the flashing lights and the shakiness of the camera. We weren't doing this originally for publication, but you can see the board turns all the way around, and you might ask how that's helpful. And that's helpful because most of these boards are designed to give a message, and the message is straight backwards. However, as we've been taught in our TIM classes, we don't like to park straight into traffic because it doesn't provide a large blocking area, and turning the wheels allows us to get that vehicle out of there if, heaven forbid, we are struck. So I'm going to go back to the presentation. And it worked twice, Paul. I'm a winner. I would like to note this was done on a closed section of roadway, so we didn't have somebody walking around a truck taking a picture of it. This is our old cash lanes from when we stopped taking cash about 10 years ago. Makes for a wonderful training environment, which hopefully y'all can take advantage of as we host another Safety Service Patrol training day. I'll get that little plug in there where I'm getting my computer correct. All right, so that rotating message board here, just a few in-action photos. In the top left, you can see we're trying to block a lane and a shoulder. We have the arrow facing traffic. The shoulder on the right, you can see we're slightly angled. We can angle the board. And then the bottom, where we say accident ahead, we're blocking for a crash in front of us. You can see we're able to pop up on the curb and block the curb and a lane and clearly get the message straight out to the public that they need to get over, there's something ahead of them, instead of a slight angle. Most message boards used, and you lose some of that visibility. And the final thing I'm going to talk about that we're working on right now, or not working on, we have deployed on all of our trucks at this time, are these alerts. Now, I showed you the rotating message board that people come upon, and they can see the message and move over. With this device, we can actually get them ahead of time, get them farther back ahead of time to let them know that we are a hazard and we are in the road. The device you see on the left-hand side is a Hoff Alert device. It connects to three wires on the light bar of our truck. Very simple. Our staff did all the installs. It was very quick, very easy, less than 30 minutes per truck, and that was taking out a large section of our board, or a portion of our truck that normally most people don't have to get to our switches. Once they're installed, they get out on the road, we program them, and you can see the little thing that pops up. That is a Waze screenshot that I took that shows it is a road hazard, emergency response vehicle nearby. It does tell people a half mile out to start identifying the road hazard. If we have more than one vehicle, all the vehicles will be saying the same thing. And I'd like to point out that if you're familiar with Waze and you thumbs down a few times in Waze, it starts to think that whatever it is gone. No matter how many times you thumb down on us, we stay there because we are directly connected to Waze, telling them that something is there and it is a true alert. Now, they do have areas that can shade off for a program that can shade areas that you're in your lots, and so you don't set off Waze alerts if you're just testing your lights in the morning before you get out on your shift. We usually show up in less than 2 minutes, and then once we flip the lights off, we're gone in less than a minute and return it back. Now, we have just finished installing on all of our trucks. We've been running it for a while now. on some test trucks. We have finished installing it all of our trucks about a month and a half ago. And so I don't have scientific data to show you our reduction in struck buys is what we're hoping to see. But I can tell you that we did put this system on some guys that have been hit several times. And if you've ever worked with some of those guys, you know that they're very hypersensitive to traffic and traffic moving over. And so we put it in their trucks. And given their skepticism about this working, we really thought they'd be perfect. And they just, on their anecdotally, did notice a difference in people moving over. Hopefully this time next year, I'm telling you that we did reduce our struck, our instance of being struck, and it really is a positive. So this is what we see inside of our dispatch unit, or our dispatch, our traffic operations center. You can see all the green, those are all the trucks that are out roaming around. Green means basically they are active and they're moving around. I took this still picture last week as they started doing all the shelter in places. It was very strange for us to see all of our vehicles in a green and none of them in the other colors, showing they're either responding or on an alert. So this was more of a showing you the state of the world. Paul mentioned earlier that it's just a little different right now. And so I went back and did find somebody. Here's a little different picture of when we are responding. It does give you a different color, and then when you're actively there and you're stopped, it does show a different color. This is not meant to be a GPS system, but you can see the direction, speed, the start, the runtime, and the alert points. On the left of this picture is a report they provide every month with the number of drivers alerted. And how many drivers they feel like were impacted by our alerts on our system. Again, this is prior to us getting full up and running with our safety cloud, and we're already at 108,000 drivers that have been impacted by the alerts. So with that, I am going to wrap up my time, but here's my name and email address. If you have any questions or want any additional information or want me to put you on a list to let you know when we have our Safety Service Patrol training day here in the fall, please email me at ehempill@ntta.org. And with that, I will turn it back over to you, Paul.
Well, thank you, Eric. Good presentation. We usually wait till questions until the end, but since we are only one more presenter, I will ask a couple of questions now. First one I'm going to ask on behalf of Jack Sullivan, who chatted in the chat pod. He asked if you can dim the emergency lights at night.
Yeah, our boards and our lights do have automatic dims on them, and we can adjust them. So we can do just the side lights, just the front, just the back, et cetera. So we are pretty flexible on our emergency lighting. We're cognizant of not on some of our roads where we have no shoulders on the left and there's just a median, we do turn off our front lights and so they're not flashing into oncoming traffic. But yes, we do have a very flexible light package.
Great. Well, I was amazed. One vehicle struck per month, and one totaled annually. Wow, that's scary. That is very scary.
Three totaled annually. Three totaled annually. One. We're about one each month, and then in addition to that, three are totaled annually.
Oh, okay. I heard you wrong. Wow, that's holy mackerel. Wow. You know, one thing that you know, tollways have that many of the rest of us don't have is the ability to purchase some of this stuff with cash and things like that. And I notice our good friend Todd Less uses those flares as well as you do, but they seem to be such an important component of helping responders with safety, especially when you're beyond, you know, a service patrol or a maintenance truck that can't carry that many cones with them. So just curious, how much does a package like that go for that you showed us of those sequential flares?
Oh, Paul, I don't recall right off the top of my head. Maybe Todd does, and he'll chime in on this chat.
Okay.
I want to say, but I did say that when we were looking at these, we looked at how many flares we would buy and how many of these we buy. And, yeah, it does cost a lot of money up front, but I can say I can say that the rate of return for us, and unfortunately I don't have the numbers sitting in front of me, you'd think I would given a presentation on them, but the rate of return basically was pretty quick because of how many incidents, just crashes alone. We typically do not deploy these on motorist assist because we're in and out so long or so quick, but we do deploy them on crashes or long-term closures or something big. And just those alone, the rate of return on the flares just versus the road flares was pretty quick, not to mention the fact that the environmental aspect of those road flares lit up. And then in Texas, it gets hot and dry in the summer, and we have a lot of grasses around our road. One little spark off into those, and we cause a whole other issue. And I saw John Leonard did type in. He said about 600. That's what I wanted to say. And thank you, because that's, I wanted to say that but didn't want to lie to everybody. So I got somebody else to lie with me. I appreciate it, John.
And Todd,
I would say, Paul, in addition to them, they are, we do get them run over by other vehicles, kicked around. I would say that I would be lying if I said we didn't break any, but the company was very good about replacing them as we break, because they are very durable and very, very strong. We do have both types. You'll see most of our guys will load up in the evening, especially the nighttime guys will load up with those sequential ones versus just the regular flares that just flash.
Oh, excellent. Okay. Well, John Leonard has said that he's paying about $600 for it. John Leonard is, by the way, is from Utah, one of the leaders in operations in general, but Tim and as well, and he paid about $600, but Todd is getting a better deal at $400. So just thought I'd let you know about that, John, in case you, it's a different package. Probably is a different package. So, but I don't want to spend too much time, and we'll come back to that later, because I want to get to our next. And there's another question, to, Eric, in there from Barbara. If you can check that out, and we'll but we'll move on to. You know, I said I had a new friend in Eric and a very old friend. That doesn't mean he's old. Alvin Marquess. Jim and I have known Alvin for many, many years. We go all go back to the I-95 Corridor Coalition efforts many years ago, 20, 25 years ago, something like that, Alvin, I think. And, you know, we learned, I in particular learned a lot from Alvin. He's an innovator and a groundbreaker in many respects, many of the things we do today. And Tim is stuff that Alvin had implemented in as I think what deputy director or something for the CHAT program in Maryland. So he was very respected in the TIM community for a long, long time. And I received a report about a peer exchange sponsored by the I-95 Corridor Coalition in Vermont. And I'm reading through the report, and they had that. My good friend Alvin was up there facilitating and helping with the peer exchange. So I said, you know something, he'd be an ideal person to have do a little report out on that peer exchange on towing, which is of course very important to all of us. So, my good friend Alvin, if you don't mind taking it from here and telling us a little bit about what happened in Vermont there.
Hi, Bob. Well, thanks for all the compliments. I do kind of miss being in the mix of things as an agency employee, but hey, it's life after retirement. This was a very good information exchange forum. I was very honored that the coalition invited me up to speak on heavy-duty towing. Denise Markow, she's the Director of Transportation Systems for the I-95, or Transportation Systems Maintenance and Operations at TISMO. Programs up in on the I-95 Corridor Coalition, along with Mary Grace Parker. They led the effort. She's the 95 Corridor Coalition's Director of Freight. They did a great job putting this thing together. I thought it was going to be called off, and kudos to Vermont. I flew in the middle of a snowstorm in New Hampshire and had to drive to upstate Vermont. Made it up there without any issues and made it back. They know how to deal with snow up there. There were a couple other presentations made by every pretty much response entity up there in trying to improve their traffic incident management program. As it relates to heavy-duty towing, and also some other issues that had come up. Todd Leese was also up there from Pennsylvania Turnpike Commission. Gosh, I can't say enough about Todd, and he's been a real hero in going out there and spreading the word, a subject matter expert on quick clearance. It's done a lot for the Pennsylvania Turnpike. And I did a small presentation on some best practices with towing. A lot of agencies in attendance. And the thing I like about information exchange forums is they're very casual, and people speak out in an open forum. They invite some neighboring agencies in to basically share some of their best practices, things that worked, things that didn't work. And it turned out to be a very productive session. Some of the agencies there, the Vermont State Police, the DMV Police, and I'll touch on them in a minute, they play a very special part in Vermont. Vermont Agency of Transportation, Towing and Recovery, the Vermont Truck and Bus Association. It was kind of good to hear their angle on things. Of course, New York State Police showed up, Connecticut State Police, New York DOT. They all did a great job. And the association, and I'm going to say this wrong, Association de Panache du Québec, which was the towing association of Quebec, Canada. And those guys were fantastic as well. Being that Vermont shares a border up there, they have some challenges that arise, so it was good to have them there. A little bit of background. The Vermont Agency of Transportation requested the 95 Carter Coalition to conduct an information exchange workshop on the subject of the heavy-duty towing. Towing's been an issue around the country here and there. Some people have got it all dialed down. It's always been a pet peeve of mine. What's the best format to use? How can we speed up the process? How can they work as part of being integrated into the incident management team? And actually, the 95 Carter Coalition had previously held two other sessions, one in Pennsylvania and one in Maine, and we heard some very good feedback from those areas that it was very well received, and there were a lot of action items that came out of those sessions that they were working on, trying to get some things implemented. And I guess you all kind of changed my notes on this one. As I was up there, and I was up there in the first part of December, Vermont was celebrating that they were leading the country on the percentage of responders trained at 67%. And I saw on the new map you put up, they've been overrun, and there were a couple states up in the Northeast that were up above 67%. So I know they're still way up there and one of the best, but they take it seriously. Even the towers up there are required to take the training if they're going to be on any of the tow lists up there. The TIM training program is coordinated by Vermont State Police. They use the National 4-Hour Training Program, Federal Highway Program. And they have implemented training in both the police and fire academies as well. That was back to that Vermont, the commercial vehicles involved, and this is where the DMV police comes in, and it meets certain criteria. Then the Department of Motor Vehicle Police, they are charged with investigating all serious commercial vehicle crashes which involve injury, death, where the vehicle needs to be towed. So they're tasked with the investigation. This kind of drove a lot of this effort here, because what happens is a lot of other states, the state police typically invest all aspects of the crash within their jurisdiction. But if the initial report of the crash is not verifiable, the trooper responds to the scene. He finds that's a commercial vehicle involved, which meets the criteria for DMV investigation. And then he has to alert dispatch that, hey, they now need a DMV investigator. So this kind of can delay the clearance of the crash. As it now warrants a second dispatch for a commercial safety vehicle investigation by the DMV investigator. And, of course, the passing of information, and I'll get into that in a little bit, between all the different agencies sometimes could be improved to kind of expedite that response. And both the Vermont State Police and the DMV Police, they are using towing rotation lists for truck crashes, heavy-duty truck crashes. And Vermont, typically, I mean, they are a very rural state. They have from 3 to 9 fatal crashes a year involving trucks along the interstate system. And as of the beginning of December, they were at 7 for the year. So they were starting to approach their upper limits, and were showing a little bit of concern. The agency perspectives, we had speakers from each agency pretty much get up. Most of the agencies I've shown here and just kind of put out some of their pertinent comments, but each agency had represented to speak, and what they were supposed to speak about was what their duties and responsibilities entailed, and what your roles and goals, the challenges they face with performing their duties, communications coordination issues, and any suggestions for improvements, especially what's working well, what's not working well, how can it be improved. It was really great to see that each agency, they did their presentations with an air of enthusiasm. You could see some pride in this room. I mean, you could feel it. And their enthusiasm for improvement was second to none. And I also like to add to the experience, the responders from neighboring states in Canada that were in attendance to share their experiences and challenges and lessons learned, they were very forthcoming. I mean, there was no holds barred. And like I say, it was a very productive meeting. Michael Coleman started out, he's the president of Vermont Towing Association, some of their concerns, and just want to add a disclaimer, there were no non-association members present. Then again, the tow show was also taking place at the same time. So this is basically coming from the association side. Their tow company service areas, and again, rural state, they could be up to 30 or 40 miles away. So it takes an hour or better to get there at times. So they need really good information, because if they don't have everything they need or they have to go back to the shop, it's that much more of a delay. And it could be delayed even more if they have severe weather conditions. He was also concerned that truck crashes, they don't happen every day. It might be a while between calls. Us in metropolitan areas don't really have that issue, I don't think. So what the challenge is trying to keep their towing skills sharp. I mean, they got to pay their employees need work to be able to earn their pay, so it's a challenge for them. And again, with staffing issues, being that they don't get a whole lot of calls, when they do, and it's a major debris field or a lot of cleanup involved, they have to call in labor forces from other businesses, such as landscapers and stuff like that, so it takes time to get some of their crews together to respond. And the compensation challenge is compounded by some trucking companies not being properly insured. And I know that's an issue in a lot of states where the truck's wrecked, the truck company doesn't care, they let it go. Now the tow company's stuck with the bill and trying to dispose of the wreckage. Sergeant Ballinger, Owen Ballinger, from the Vermont State Police, I'm surprised he has time to do anything. he's involved with the towing program for the state police, traffic incident manager and quick clearance programs, member of the crash investigation team, and I had to list all these because it just amazed me, and part of his duties included coordinating TIM training program. This guy is really involved, drone program, everything else. Basically, he explained that the state police currently investigate serious crash teams, and I hadn't heard this term in a while, but the baseline tape method, which is something that Maryland went away from a while back. And they're also using total stations. Now, again, they started to play a little bit with drones, so we'll get into that in a little bit. They did receive four drones for crash investigations. They've been able to play with them a little bit, trying to shorten the time it takes to perform a crash investigation to get the incidents cleared up quicker. And when they did try one out for a crash investigation, it captured the whole scene in 7 minutes. It's a huge time savings. Again, the cost of the delays and secondary incidents by being able to get the road open that much quicker pays off exponentially. They also, when they receive a call from dispatch for a crash along the interstate, they dispatch Virginia State Police. And again, one of the issues that he brought up is once they get there, they have to notify the DMV police because they weren't part of the initial call out. But one of the issues he did bring up is the process works well if the dispatchers, if it's a seasoned dispatcher or through training, they ask the agency on the scene the right questions so they can obtain the information that the DMV investigators would need to determine their appropriate response. They need two investigators, they need one, they need three. Is it something that really doesn't fit their criteria and they can maybe get cleared up a little bit quicker with the units already on the scene? So that's one of the challenges he brought out. The next speaker was Lieutenant Gene Coate. And I'm just trying to get everybody to have a flavor of how the whole session went. And some of these folks had some very valid points. The DMV police, Lieutenant Coate, basically said they have very limited manpower. So if they're tied up on one crash, it's going to be a while before they can get to a second one. They could really use some additional investigators to help them meet the demands of their investigation process and also have them located strategically around the state to lessen some of the response time. And he also brought up the fact that they needed dispatchers asking the right questions to get the information they need into determining their response. And he also suggested that it would be beneficial if the DMV police could talk directly to the state police or other responders on the scene, get firsthand information. Sometimes it doesn't translate good back to a dispatcher or to get that transfer of more people. You go through the more information, you start to lose from the original message. So he thought that might be a good solution to try and work on. And then Bill Smith, he was with the Truck and Bus Association, and he had an interesting take on this, and he represents all the bus and tow companies up there. And one of his biggest concerns, or their biggest concerns, are the rates that the tow companies are charging the truck and bus companies when they're involved in a commercial vehicle crash. Some of the rates, they seem to be much higher than others for the same type of crash. And they were having a hard time trying to figure this out. So I'll get into some of the challenges later, but what it was brought up is they could maybe work with the towing association a little bit closer or all the tow companies so there's better documentation in the tow bills and what they're being charged for, what they're not being charged for. He also suggested better documentation of the tow bills, again, to basically show what they're doing out there on the scene of that crash that would warrant some of these high tow bills. Some of them, and one of the towers brought out that, in that particular crash, we needed to have specialized gloves and boots because of a hazardous incident, so we had to charge you for those because they're no good after the first use. So some of these other things, they want to try and get better documented before they get their bills. And he also suggested getting a meeting together with tow companies, the truck and bus companies, and insurance companies. Because the insurance companies need to know really how much insurance these trucking companies need to have to be able to cover some of the tow costs when they are involved in some of these crashes. Because they've been having some issues with a lot of underinsured vehicles. Then we went a little bit of some presentations. Todd Leese from Pennsylvania Turnpike, he did a great presentation, traffic incident management, safe quick turns, lessons learned. Todd's the program manager for the Pennsylvania Turnpike Commission, and they actually use contractual towing by zone, and I'm bringing that up, and I'm going to touch on that a little bit later. And actually, they've got a pretty good system worked out because their TMC dispatches both responders and tow operators at the same time. Basically, they're under contract, so they have better control of how they can expedite some of the response after the scenes. And the tow company arrives is not needed. They actually pay them a dry run fee. It's only $24, but it would cover their fuel, I guess. And Todd, he has a video that he keeps updated. Paul had talked about line of duty deaths of responders. Todd actually puts it into a video, and is. Unfortunately, we lose another brother from the field. He adds that person to his video. I did put the link in here for folks to see. If they want to check it out. It's a pretty touching video and something good to see. Todd also kind of explained why safe quick clearance is important. He's kind of preaching to the choir. We're all kind of getting this down. But what they are doing there is also some really good data collection, showing what the cost is for each different incident in relationship to how long it took to clear the incident, what the queue was, and other factors. I gave a quick presentation on best practices and lessons learned in heavy duty towing. Basically, I focused on some of the various types of towing programs that are implemented throughout the country and the interagency coordination, how both subjects can improve safe quick clearance of incidents, especially those involving commercial vehicles. Again, there's towing, like I said, it's been a pet peeve of mine most of my career with the state, and still I think there's a lot of room to examine some of these programs that are out there. Like I say, some are really good, some need some fine-tuning. Some of the examples I used were rotation list towing, towing rotation by zone, contract towing, instant dispatch towing, which was something we did pilot in Maryland for a short time, and I knew Washington State's done a lot of work with, and towing recovery incentive programs. Of course, Florida, Georgia, the two biggest ones that kicked it off, and a lot of states are now jumping on board with that, and some of the benefits that they, you know, realized through those programs. I also touched a little bit on winter operations, which they have some issues there as far as contracting heavy-duty tows for winter events and having to pre-stage in different locations. Best practices being used by other states, you know, heavy-duty record contracts, mandatory chain restrictions where large commercial vehicles are required to install chains to their drive wheels at the provided chain-up locations, and the closing or restricting of roadways to commercial vehicles during extreme winter weather conditions. Some states, such as Pennsylvania, and there are a few others that, if the weather's predicted to be really bad, they just close the road to commercial vehicles, which I guess can have its own problems as well as leaving them open. So it's a balancing act, and each state has their own needs. Some of the challenges that came out of the information exchange forum was that, of course, the Vermont DMV police investigation has limited manpower, which at times can lead to a less than desired response time. Canadian commercial vehicles, and this was interesting to find out, when they're involved in a crash, they need to be towed back to Canada. So now you got the investigators that want to hold the vehicle, and you got the Canadian authorities saying, "Oh, no, that's my truck, it comes back to Canada." And the kicker is, it needs to be towed by a Canadian tow vehicle. So now we have to contact Canada to have one of our heavy-duty wreckers come down and pick up their truck and take it back to Canada. So one of the issues with that is they need to work closely with their Canadian partners on how can they work around some of these issues and make sure that everybody gets what they need. There were issues with trucks using navigation tools such as Waze and Google Maps. I'm a Waze guy. I heard you talk about Waze data earlier. But the only problem with these, and it's something that I'd really like to see somebody work on, is including truck-specific routing information. Because without that, what happens is the truckers, especially in Vermont, they're seeing the roadways closed, it's impacted, they're being diverted off onto another roadway. They're following that diversion. That roadway may not be suitable for trucks. And as a result, a lot of the trucks are using routes that they're prohibited from using. They get stuck for low bridges, weight restrictions. And it seems to be a real issue up there. There's one problem area along State Route 9 between Stowe, which is one of the ski resorts, and Smuggler's Knot, another ski resort. The road's very narrow, and once the trucks get stuck, it's hard to get to them to even pull them out with a tow truck. It basically shuts the road down. The route's signed before the trucks even get on it, and they know if they use the route, they get fined $1,000. And if they get caught more than once, the fine keeps going up. But they keep using that route because Waze told them to. Another challenge was the requirements on a heavy-duty towing rotation list may need to be revised, as some of the companies who can meet the current requirements do not have the equipment to handle some of the crashes. So they really need to update what equipment is required of these companies that are going to be on a heavy-duty towing list and modify them to make sure it's going to meet their needs for clearing these heavy-duty wrecks and getting the right companies on board. And that was another thing I'd like to see a little bit more of, is maybe another classification. You got light-duty towing, medium-duty towing, heavy-duty towing. Why not specialize heavy-duty recovery? Yes, you might have fewer companies on there, but it's going to be them specialty wrecks that really require the specialty equipment. some other challenges they identified, and this was a big one, and this came up several times. Being in real estate, there's some areas that are limited to no cell phone coverage or very little cell phone coverage throughout Vermont. So one of the challenges of trying to relay some of this information is you can't talk directly to the scene unless it's by two-way radio if you have the same frequencies, because the cell service isn't any good. You can't transmit video from a service patrol vehicle or a police vehicle. Again, you might not be in a cell service area. So that was one of the challenges they have up there with communications. And another thing they identified as a challenge is, and they're doing some good things, and I think it's just a learning curve right now, was they consolidated a lot of their public safety dispatch centers, or it's public safety answering points. And by doing that, they relocated folks that might have been in one county to another county, from one region to another, and they're not as familiar with the roadway system as they used to be. So sometimes they're getting calls. They're still a little bit slow in trying to sort everything out, where exactly this is, what the roadway looks like, and any other characteristics that a seasoned dispatcher that's been dispatching that same area for years would have. So it's, again, I think it's just a learning curve that they'll work through. They're also looking to maybe have some additional training for some of the dispatchers to get to know the area a little bit better, maybe some ride-alongs, so they can start to get over that hump of the challenges that came about as consolidation of the dispatch centers. Potential action items. Some of the potential action items that they identified. And I've got these on the next three slides. There were quite a few, which is one good thing about these information exchange forums. There's a lot of ideas that are flowing back and forth. I just picked out the ones that seem to be get the most bang for the buck. There was a lot more than what I'm going to talk about here. One of the things was to improve ways that responding agencies can get direct communications to other agencies at the scene of an incident. And we have poor cell service, so how can we maybe share radio frequencies? How can we train the dispatch folks? Towing companies, they'd like to improve their communications with the Vermont State Police and Department of Motor Vehicle Police. So I guess if they have questions, they're getting their call from the dispatch center. If they have questions on what equipment they need to bring ahead of time or what exactly is a picture of that incident on the ground at the scene, they'd be able to maybe contact them so they initiate the right response the first time, so there's no delay in some of the response, they bring the right equipment. Consider looking for ways to send pictures or video from the scene to responding tow companies to help the tow company better understand what's involved, kind of what I was talking about with the communications, but more in a video type of format. Again, some of the issues are the communications that might hurt that a little bit. Looking to find ways to have dispatchers and responders become more familiar with each other and their roles, as well as the diverse geography of regions to enhance event management. Basically, what's going on is, again, you have some dispatchers that aren't familiar with some of the areas with their new routines. And it was the colonel of the Department of Motor Vehicle Police, Jake, who basically had talked about whenever he was going home in the evening after his shift, he had quite a drive. He would call the TMC dispatch folks, and they knew each other back and forth. Again, being a smaller state, they have more relationships up there, and they want to kind of build back on that relationship and the trust and passing of information. Wanted to have the towing association, along with non-association tow companies, meet to develop a checklist. Checklist for the public safety dispatchers. What do they need? What kind of information do they need? This key information that the public safety dispatcher would be able to maybe to ask the folks in the field, the responders on the scene, hey, is the truck leaking? What's it leaking? What's it? How much does it weigh? What's it loaded with? You know, these kind of questions that really help the tow company to determine what kind of response they're going to initiate. And basically, they want the state police want them to get that list together and then come back to the table and discuss with the state police on any changes they might be able to make. And checklists seem to be a popular action item up there for everybody. FHWA companies provide a better description or justification of charges that make up the tow bill. We touched on that a little earlier. Review the revised crash reporting forms that the Vermont Agency of Transportation is using to better understand the incidents that are occurring, how they're occurring, the characteristics, and the type of responses they're receiving. So I'll like kind of critiquing some of the past incidents to refine some of the way they respond. And they're also looking at maybe annually or semi-annually convening a meeting to include 10 personnel, public safety dispatchers, VSP, DMV police, discuss issues, possible solutions, almost like a TIM summit that would happen again at once or twice a year to bring everybody's ideas together to keep everything fresh. they also want to work on establishing the meeting between the tow companies that we talked about with the bus and truck companies and insurance companies so they can start talking and learn how to start working together better. Especially with how the tow bill is prepared, how the vehicles are insured, what the insurance companies and trucking companies, bus companies should expect when they get certain kind of services from the tow companies. Joint classes, this was a big thing between the DMV, commercial vehicle investigators, and the Virginia State Police. And basically this would be to train the young troopers relative to the information that's needed to assess an event. So young trooper would pull up on the scene, he would basically have an idea of what the DMV police are going to need before they initiate their response to try and speed things up a little bit and shorten the timeline on the incident itself. You'd like to do a little more research and collect some best practice information from other states regarding pay rate schedules, certification, and equipment requirements, all in trying to help develop new procedures for Vermont. Bring in all public agency stakeholders together to develop and agree to a plan to bring the towing response to Vermont to the next level. Again, that goes along with changing out some of the existing requirements for getting on the heavy-duty tow list and maybe some of the other lists. And do they go away from a rotation list or do they stay with a rotation list? They do a rotation by zone. Do they go with a heavy-duty recovery? So that's something they wanted to get a little bit more information on and basically put a plan together. Looking at that, looking at basically the whole TIM program, and submit it to the executive team. It's a multi-agency approach for possible legislative action. A lot of things that they need to do up there that are want to accomplish would need some of the legislative backing. Follow-up items. Again, I'm just going to run through these pretty quick. There are a few follow-up items, more than I've mentioned, that I will be mentioning on this slide. They want to continue the meetings between VTrans, which is the Vermont Department of Transportation, Vermont State Police, DMV Police, and the other response agencies. They want them to happen on a regular basis to kind of constantly refine their interagency communications coordination efforts and how can they keep advancing their TIM efforts in a productive fashion. Continue training of responders. They have a very good program up there, and they're very interested in keeping that program going. So they want that to remain a high priority. The Vermont agencies agreed that the next step would be to meet together at a follow-up. And that meeting, following that Information Exchange Network meeting, basically they want the meeting to provide an opportunity for the agencies to identify which of these action items to advance and a timeline for them. When do they plan to get it done, as well as determining the appropriate staffing for agencies, for leadership, and a lot of collaboration between the agencies in trying to move the whole program forward in a productive fashion. Again, overall, the information exchange forum, it seemed to be very well received by all. It was a very great session. Again, I was honored to be a part of it. I really had a good time while I was up there. I was just to take notes and basically do a presentation. Very good discussions regarding the current operations and responses to incidents. Folks were not shy about sharing. It was really great. And they had some good suggestions for improvements. The other agencies that came up, the Connecticut State Police, New York State Police, New York DOT, Pennsylvania Turnpike Commission, and the Canadian Towers, they provide a great overview. Excuse me. Sorry about that. I'm not quarantined. I do not, thank you. I do not have the coronavirus. I've been sitting home for a long time.
Well, go wash your hands.
I always do. these other agencies, they were very forthcoming. Yeah. And there's a lot of good lessons learned going back and forth. That even the folks up there to supply information, I think they took some good information back home with them. So that was pretty much it in a nutshell. We just had, and Karen Songhurst, the representative who was there from the Secretary of Transportation's office, she was very supportive and also let the group know that if there were any good ideas that they wanted to move forward on, that the Secretary's office could possibly or most probably have funding available to try some of these practices. And that was pretty much in a nutshell. Again, I was very honored to be there. And there's my email address and number if anybody has any questions or would like more information or follow-up. I'm not sure if the report is posted on the I-95 Carter Coalition's website. I imagine it probably is, and if it is, there's a lot more detail in there than what you got from me today. So thank you.
Thank you, Alvin. Great job as usual. Really appreciate it. Angela Roper Barnett is been around, knows many of us. She's been around a while. She's not as old as Alvin and I, but she does know her way around towing, and she does know her way around Tim. And she made some good comments here, so go back and look at them. One is about the invoice from the towers should really tell a story. And the other thing I found interesting here in the chat pod was from Matthew Manansky. I don't want to say that wrong, but when we're talking rural, I was in Wyoming once, and we were talking on a workshop about how they were unhappy with their towing service, and I said, "Well, fire is ass," and they all started laughing at me. I said, "What are you laughing at?" They said, "Well, because he's the only one, then he's got to go back and get the ambulance." So, when we're talking rural, I think we need to, just be creative with how we deal with, rural towers versus, what we might be able to do in the city and things like that. So, great presentations by everybody today. I just thought we'd take our last few minutes here and, this whole coronavirus thing is probably going to get worse before it gets better, and it's seeing an impact. So I was watching some emails through the I-95 Carter Coalition, the Operations Academy listserv, and they were talking about how all the states were chiming in about the reduction in volume. And which makes sense, everyone's staying home. But I found it interesting, North Carolina, Jennifer Canover, another friend, she mentioned it, but they haven't had a reduction in commercial vehicle crashes. So they're having the same number of crashes, even though they, the volume is down, cut in half. At 50%. So I'm wondering if that's what everybody else is seeing. I know volumes have probably down. I've been out a few times and volumes are really down, but have you seen a reduction in crashes? Or is crashes staying the same? And are any other thoughts you have related to your experience on this whole virus thing? I was talking to New Jersey, Sal Cohen, yesterday, and, they're making adjustments. The service patrols are operating as usual, but they're taking extra precautions, of course, but they might have to go to a plan B on that if it moves forward and a lot of other activities. They're moving around their construction jobs. They're still continuing with construction jobs. And because of the volume, they're able to get more work done. But then some other jobs are being canceled. So just wondering if anyone has had any experiences they want to share relative to the virus and this whole disaster that's happening to us.
Hey, Paul, also on the center or the Operations Academy listserv, the issue again with the partners about posting of COVID-19 messages on DMS is worth mentioning, because that's something that isn't always the case, but some states are moving forward with posting messages.
Yeah, true enough. Because everyone's trying to find their own way with this thing. It came on pretty quickly, our world, and now we're just trying to find our way, I guess. But Kevin Smith from Georgia is saying there's a large reduction in volume, but the crashes they're having are at a higher speed. That's a good point. So the volumes are down, but we're having higher speeds. Thanks, Kevin. So, you know, we're going to probably see more severe crashes. We might have, maybe have a reduction in the number of crashes, but more severe. So that's a good point. Maybe that's what we need to prepare for moving forward over the next several months. Jim, did you have anything else? I know you chimed in.
Yeah, Paul. Yeah, one quick thing. I have to make a correction. Earlier, my old age, I mentioned a train-to-trainer. That is going to occur in the summer, and I said Nevada, but it's actually in Utah, Salt Lake City, Utah. John Leonard that chimed in earlier, his state is the one that's going to, with our support, sponsor a train the trainer. So I just want to be clear on that. I made an error. Pat Gallagher that I mentioned in Nevada is the contractor now supporting with Parsons. They're supporting Utah's TIM program, so yeah. I just wanted to get that in real quick.
Pat Gallagher, retired state police, now contractor. That's good. That's good. Good information.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, Paul.
Yes, sir. Alvin.
Hey, Paul, I see there was one comment from Relax that basically said that Todd Lice's link wasn't working from our presentation, and I saw that Todd had typed in that he had changed. I guess he's trying to make it hard for us. But I don't know if there's a way we could send out the new link, or if any, Relax, and I'm probably saying that wrong, and I apologize. If you are still on, if you look at the comments that people have been typing in, Todd's got two links he posted just above yours. So that's the new address.
Yeah, Todd put the new addresses. And you're right. It is very, very compelling. On that video, and I'm afraid to use it, frankly. So just a heads up on the next, the April Talking Tim, and we just, it was posted in the chat pod because I couldn't remember up front. I did find it since then. So Colorado is they have a kind of a unique approach to traffic incident management. They've been very active in TIM for a long time. The State Patrol has taken the lead, and the captain, I won't steal his thunder, but the captain from Colorado is going to explain the program. From the Colorado State Police is going to explain that. I'm very pleased to announce that Massachusetts has the highest percentage, or close to the highest percentage. I don't know if South Carolina was there, with training success. So I want to talk about their success stories. And many of you know that I'm from Massachusetts, and I'll take full credit for that, but I had absolutely nothing to do with it. It's Ed Genikaukas, who is leading that program, with several others that have been instrumental behind that success story. And then Jim and I wanted to share some of the marketing stuff that we've been doing. We've increased. We actually got some contractor support, some real professionals that are helping us with marketing. So we wanted to see if we share a little bit of information on that and see how we can leverage with you on the on our marketing effort. And I actually have ahead of myself a little bit of starting to plan for the May, and I have at least one pretty cool presentation on connected and automated vehicle research out of the Vermont Virginia Technology, Research Institute or something like that, but I forget the exact facility name, and other responder research. So it's not just connected automated vehicle. Then at least one other presentation on that, and maybe two. So I wanted to share that with you. But there's some the Haas alert that Eric talked about. I think that's the future. That's where we're going. I think that's going to be a big deal in helping responders. That's where connected automated vehicles is going, right? We're going to be able to communicate with vehicles upstream and actually let vehicles, whether they're driver or driverless, know when there's a responder in the roadway. It's got a long way to go, but that's the infancy. That's where we're starting. So those Haas alerts certainly have promise. So I want to. There's a few other things being
typed Paul. In the
chat. But, yep, Jim.
Yeah, can you ask real quick about the secondary crash data? If anybody has any hard data for state and/or arterial.
Yeah, great idea. Great idea. So Jim and I are trying to. You know, we know a lot more people are collecting secondary crash data, and we're looking to we're looking for information. Any secondary crash data that you have that you can get, or you can maybe reach out to your whoever manages the crash report or at the TMC or whatever. We're interested in that report. We're interested in trying to dive into it a little bit deeper, in particular rural arterial versus mainline and interstate type high speed roadways. So but any data that you have on secondary crashes in particular, we're looking for. So if you had anything, if you could find something, we really sure would appreciate it. Good catch, Jim. Thanks for that reminder. Anything else, Jim, before we sign off?
Nothing here, Paul. Just a big thank you to everyone.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. And look forward to seeing you next month. And great call, and I really appreciate what everyone is doing out there, and most of all, stay safe, social distance when you can. I know it's not always possible, but thanks again. Take care.